Believe me, I've read through the scripture literally hundreds of times looking for it because it didn't make sense to me. I'm going, wait a minute, half of our staff are women. Half of our church are women. Half the world are women. What's going on here? It just didn't make sense. So I struggled with this. I'm being honest with you. I struggled with this for years because it didn't make sense to me.
That's not ambiguous. That's not at all unclear. It is improper for a woman to speak in church. That is an absolute prohibition. And the word improper is chosen very, very carefully by the Holy Spirit to leave no lack of clarity as to the force of the statement. The word that is translated improper is eiskros in the Greek. It really is a word that means disgraceful or shameful. It's something more than just improper. It's disgraceful. In fact, that is the way it is translated in 1 Corinthians 11:6 by the word disgraceful. That is the way it is translated in Ephesians 5, verse 12, as disgraceful or shameful. That same word is used in Titus 1:11, and there it is translated sordid, sordid. A word that basically means base or shameful. It has the common sense of something that is known to be a disgrace.
The case of requiring ordaining three women pastors is the epitome of irony. Requiring acted as if his fame and prominence gave him authority over scripture. Far from it. No matter what we do, the word of God will never change. Not a single jot, nor a single stroke of pen will disappear from the eternal word of the living God. Twist it all you want to fit your agenda, but the eternal word of the living God will never change.
Do you think that women in evangelical circles where women are not allowed to preach, let's say that Palin and McCain do win, and here you have this woman that could possibly be leading the free world, and yet there's evangelicals voting for her that don't even believe that a woman should preach at the pulpit. Could this change the face of how evangelicals believe in the woman's role?
I don't think it'll change the way evangelicals believe about women's roles. I think it has sparked a discussion. And quite frankly, feminism has gained a foothold in many evangelical churches.
Do you think that's a good thing?
No, I don't. Not at all.
Why not?
Well, because we're about the gospel. The culture doesn't dictate truth. The gospel dictates truth. My job is not to be a political pundit or political activist. My job is to be a pastor and proclaim the truth of the gospel as clearly as I possibly can.
Well, wait a minute. What about the Old Testament and the prophet Deborah? I mean, she was a political leader. She was a wife. She was a mother. She was one of the biggest forces in the book of Judges. So that's the gospel right there.
She certainly was. And the fact that something happened doesn't mean that it's normative for the church. In Isaiah chapter 3, for example, one of the signs that a culture is under judgment is that women are in leadership in their nations. So Deborah was actually a sign that things were very bad in Israel, not a norm for the church.
Margaret, I'm curious to see what you think about this and what the Reverend's saying.
I think that that's a fair perspective, Bodhi, but I think we also need to look at Ephesians 5, which describes, you know, it's saying that husbands are to lay down their lives for their wives, just as Jesus Christ laid down his life for the church. And in the same way, I think Todd has done an incredible job opening up the opportunity for Palin to use the gifts and the talents and the passions that she has been given in order to make a difference in her community and possibly in our nation and world on a significant political landscape and effect.
Margaret, is the Reverend sounding a little sexist or is it just me?
I would have to say the Reverend is sounding a little questionable there, but in the sense that I believe that everyone, despite gender, has an opportunity to serve, to give, and to play a role in making a difference in their communities, in their churches, and around the world.
Reverend, this could be an exciting time. I mean, this could break through or become being progressive in so many ways. We're seeing a black man possibly winning the presidency. We're seeing a woman here that's on the Republican ticket that's, you know, rousing up evangelicals of possibly to think twice about the woman's role in the church. I mean, this is fascinating times.
They are fascinating times, and they're also frightening times. When you see Margaret Feinberg, you use Ephesians chapter 5, which clearly says that a husband is the head of the wife, in order to justify somehow with this sleight of hand that Palin's husband is laying down his life by allowing her to do that. Number one, she's playing fast and loose with the text. And secondly, she is also ignoring the fact that Palin's responsibility as wife and mother is governed by scripture, not by whether we feel it's progressive in our culture.
Margaret, final thought
but
there.
Bodhi, I believe that's a narrow interpretation and a boxy interpretation of the text, as well as the role of women, who in today's working families, many families in the United States need both the man and the wife in order to work outside of the home, in order to support the family, and to put that kind of burden on the family, whereby a woman must stay at home, I just don't think that translates into many working class families today.
You know, my job is not to translate into working class families. My job is to be honest with the text. And the text says in Titus chapter 2 and verse 5, a woman is to be the keeper of her home. Now, I will not violate the teaching of the text in order to somehow sound more appropriate for the culture. I am a herald of the truth of the gospel, and my job is to teach the gospel according to what the authors have said, not according to what
we're gonna tear your kingdom down, Lord Jesus. Oh,
Satan, we're gonna tear your kingdom down.
Our gates, Jubin, building your kingdom, yeah. The preachers are gonna preach your kingdom down. Good God Almighty, and yeah. For the preachers
are gonna preach
your kingdom down. Oh, yes, you've been building your kingdom. Oh, yes. Not only that, but listen up, for the mothers are going to pray your kingdom down. Good God Almighty,
for the mothers are gonna pray your kingdom down.
You know what? Not only that, but listen. Satan, we're gonna tear your kingdom down. Yes, we are. Oh, Satan, we're gonna bring it down. Oh, yes. I got one more verse, listen. But the deacons are gonna pray your kingdom down. Glory be to God
for the deacons.
Oh, yes.
We're gonna pray your kingdom down.
They're gonna pray down. You've been building your kingdom.
Satan, we're gonna tear your kingdom down.
Dealing with the story of the prophetess Deborah, and we're gonna be dealing with this topic as it relates to the Old Testament as well. What most Christians need to understand, especially in their critical thinking, is narrative is not always normative. During the time that Deborah was a judge in Israel, the children of Israel were in a very bad state of judgment as it pertains to them breaking the laws, statutes, and precepts of God. So, this being said, during the time of Deborah, men were not being men. And so the reason why we say that narrative is not always normative. Now, what do we mean by that? What you see in the narrative, i.e. the story of Deborah, does not translate as being normative in the teaching of our faith. Therefore, if we was to look at the narrative of Peter when he cut off the centurion's ear, that was the narrative. But of course, it is not normative for Christians to go around cutting off non-believers' ears. Does that make sense? Well, I hope it do, because sometimes we as black folk in the Christian church, Negroes in the Christian church, we tend to not think critically when it comes to scripture. And we have to learn to think that way because of the way the world views us in many instances as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, Rick Warren is a feminist. In reading Rick Warren's bio and his accomplishments, we noticed several red flags when reading about him on Wikipedia. And I quote, Warren has been invited to speak at national and international forums, including the United Nations, the World Economic Forum in Davos, the African Union, the Council on Foreign Relations, Harvard Kennedy School, TED, T-E-D, and Times Global Health Summit. He has been a member of the Council of Foreign Relations, the CFR, since 2005. All these organizations are either bought and paid for or affiliated with the global elites and Zionists who were involved in one way or another with the creation of the kill shot. And of course, to keep from triggering the Facebook and YouTube algorithms, we use the term kill shot because of the extreme censorship on these media platforms. This alone should be enough to tell you that they have an agenda in place. And conversely, these organizations are on board with the feminist movement. And what a lot of people don't understand, especially a lot of black Christians don't understand, is one of the major platforms that the feminist movement is pushing on our society today is abortion rights, along with Planned Parenthood. Hence the reason why Rick Warren has no problem with ordaining women over his organization's churches. Margaret Feinberg. Margaret Feinberg is Jewish. The Wikipedia article on her says that her father was a Jewish convert to Christianity. Really? This fact alone puts her in the suspect category, knowing that the Ashkenazi Jews have an agenda working to corrupt the Goy, i.e., the nations. Now, I have a hard time thinking that she's not a double agent. Margaret Feinberg is also a feminist, and the Jews promote these kinds of organizations for their own purposes of controlling and destroying Gentiles, as also abortion and the LGBT agenda. So this is my take regarding her person. Okay, all right, so let's go back to work. Doing our cursory interpretation of the pertinent passages. So now we're looking at Titus, the second chapter, verse 3-5. There in Titus, the second chapter, verse 3-5, it reads, "The aged women, likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed." So the older women are instructed in these passages of scripture first to behave as older women, behaving in holiness, not to deal in accusations, and not to drink wine to the point of drunkenness, etc. The older women are to teach the younger women how to be a woman. So in this respect, a woman can teach other women how to be sober, how to take care of their households, and to love their husbands. This is in the Bible. So now, question. What was the gender of the persons called to preach? And what was the gender of the persons recognized by the ancient church as preachers and evangelists? Were they male or female? This is the question we will seek to answer at this time. My hope would be that you would follow me in your Bibles as we present the evidence. First up, John the Baptist. St. Matthew's, the third chapter, verse 1-4. "In those days came John the Baptist, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Esaias, saying, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight." And the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leather girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey. So, John the Baptist was the first preacher ever called in the New Testament. He did not go through a church ceremony to legitimize his calling as a preacher. God called him to preach the baptism of repentance, and he was a man. Now, the English word preaching that we find in this St. Matthew 3, 1 and 4 text is the Greek word keruso. The word means to be a herald, to officiate as a herald, and to proclaim. So what is a herald? The word herald in our English dictionaries appears as a noun. And here's the definition: an official messenger bringing news, a person or thing viewed as a sign that something is about to happen. All these definitions apply to what John the Baptist was doing. He proclaimed the news that one mightier than himself was coming, and he would baptize, not with water, but with the Holy Ghost. This was the message he preached. Next up, we have the Apostle Peter. Acts the 2nd chapter, verse 14. But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, "Ye men of Judea, and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words." And also Acts the 4th chapter, verse 1 and 2. And as they spake unto the people, the priest and the captain of the temple and the Sanhedrin and the Sadducees came upon them, being grieved that they taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. Now, with respect to the apostles, they were all men. They knew that Christ had commissioned them to preach to the preaching ministry. And they were ministers of the gospel as well as preachers of the gospel. So the Bible shows us. Such was the Apostle Peter in Acts the 2nd chapter, verse 14 and Acts 4 and 2. Peter is seen preaching the first and the second Christian sermon. At Acts 4, 2, Peter and John were at the temple preaching through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. Then the Apostle Peter was really considered to be the preacher that preached the first sermon ever preached in the history of the church. His introduction, if you will, deals with prophecy fulfilled, specifically Joel's prophecy. Then at verse 22, we may view what quite possibly was the subject of his sermon. Jesus of Nazareth. That was the subject of his sermon. Next, we have the Apostle Paul. Romans, the first chapter, verse 1 to 7. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his son Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom are ye also the called of Jesus Christ, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So, the apostle to the Gentiles. God selects Paul and Barnabas to go to the Gentiles with the gospel. But Paul is chosen to be the apostle to the Gentiles, and Barnabas is his partner in this ministry. And in this capacity, the church officially recognizes Paul by the laying on of hands. The church ordained him along with Barnabas to go to the Gentiles after God the Holy Spirit confirmed them and set them aside for this office. By this time, Paul understood that he was an apostle, indeed an apostle to the Gentiles, because of his personal and powerful encounter with the Lord himself. Paul had seen the Lord on the road to Damascus. Now, the word apostle means a delegate, messenger, one sent forth with orders. First, specifically applied to the 12 apostles of Christ. And second, in a broader sense, applied to other eminent Christian teachers. This term is never a term that is used to describe women. Acts, the 13th chapter, verse 1 through 3. Now there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simon and Simeon, that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manaen, which had been brought up with Herod the tetrarch, and Saul. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, "Separate me Barnabas and Saul for the work whereunto I have called them." And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. So now we'll continue in our next slide presentation, lesson slide presentation. Shalom.
Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more backward thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There is so much hatred, war and poverty. Oh, oh yeah, yeah.
Wake up all the teachers, time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have to say. Just you and me.